Okay, so my next guest, he is a producer. He was an artist once upon a time. He's an exec at a label. Please welcome Kawan KP Prather. So tell them, KP, who is KP?
Oh man, KP is a boy who was raised in Vine City here in Atlanta.
Vine City.
Yeah, y'all are kind of in it almost. But no, I grew up literally a mile away from here on a street called Tyler Street, corner of Tyler and Rock Street. But I was just always that kid who wanted to figure things out. So, you know, I grew up watching my mom, who was, you know, fairly young, getting ready to go out to clubs and listening to records like this lady named Anita Ward, and she had a record called Ring My Bell.
Yes, we all know it.
Okay, so yeah. So my mom, I used to watch her get ready to go to a club, and that she had this look, like it was like, man, she looked like she's having fun. Right. I want to do stuff that makes people feel like that.
Yeah.
So I then started figuring out the people who were involved in, people who were involved in making those records. Mm-hmm. And how everybody had different parts to it, and it wasn't just the lady Anita Ward. And you know, I started reading credits and who was writing records, and you know, I just started paying attention. And that was, I might have been 5, 6, trying to figure out who was Quincy Jones, and because Michael Jackson said, if it was for Quincy, or you know, all those kind of things, they kind of made me just pay attention. Like if Michael Jackson thinks that person's important,
I need to know
what he does.
Right.
And then somewhere around 7th, 8th grade, I heard this record, Herbie Hancock record called Rocket.
Mm-hmm.
And it was that little noise in it. And I just wanted to understand what it was. And a friend of mine showed me the whole scratching thing. And then that Christmas, my mom got me 2 turntables, and I started DJing. And that's literally how I started doing music.
And like, that was what age?
That was 12.
12. Okay, I remember us hanging out at Jelly Beans back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
So, KP used to be a part of a group called PA, Parental Advisory. Anybody mm-hmm. know about this group?
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, yeah, me, woo, woo. back in the day, I thought you guys were so dope personally. Mellow, Reed.
I did too, man.
I thought y'all were dope. And... What did you learn as an artist at that point in time? Do you feel like that shaped you for what you were doing the next step of your life, the second phase of your life?
Yeah, absolutely. Because I didn't go to a formal college. Mm-hmm. I went to the world almost,
yes,
like instantly. Like we, at coming out of high school, we got a record deal with Pebbles, mm-hmm. at this company called Savvy Records.
Yeah.
And Pebbles was married to L.A. Reid. L.A. Reid heard our music. Pebbles got us a deal at LaFace. And we were the first group out of our crew, the Dungeon Family, to get a deal. So we were kind of like the guinea pigs.
Mm-hmm.
But we, you know, it was a crew of really, really, really talented people. But none of us knew what we were doing or why or what the roles were.
Mm-hmm.
We were just doing things. And L.A. Reid came in and kind of started labeling us like, what you're really doing is producing. Like, I know you're a DJ, yeah, but that's production.
Right.
Or that's promotion. The guy who talks all the time, he's a promoter. Like, and it was like, oh, so these things that we kind of characterize our friends as were like our talents.
Right.
And, you know, it put us in positions to take advantage of information that we wouldn't have gotten. Because in the group, we got to travel. We were on the road with Tribe Called Quest and the Fugees and... You know, we were like big, but we were the smallest people on the road. We were absolutely the opening act for the Fugees, Tribe Called Quest, Black Eyed Peas. But what it gave me was it made me understand how much work everybody else was putting in.
Right. You pioneered the movement.
Yeah, well, we guinea pigged the movement, yeah.
Yeah.
But we all learned what our actual blessings were.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I learned how to produce because Outkast got a deal and Rico and them got busy.
Yeah.
So it made everybody start working harder, like to get attention from each other.
Mm-hmm.
And we had like in Atlanta at that moment, we had the premier crew, like because we were kind of like, you know, and I'm sure everybody says this now, y'all sold all the records and let people know that it was talent viable in Atlanta.
Right.
But OutKast was able to take all of our experiences and just make a really cohesive Atlanta project that, you know, based on all the people. Like, I grew up in Vine City. I lived in College Park. You know, me and Jermaine hung out and we had sleepovers. We were, like, all of us were friends. So we were taking all this information, putting it into these two dudes. And they were young enough to translate all this sometimes grown information, sometimes really high school information. And we just, again, we all learned how to be a team at that point and understood, like, this was the point. People like watching this the most.
Right.
Let's put the best records, the best ideas all went to that. Mm-hmm. And it kind of, it just showed, it we learned how to be teams.
You guys were, it was, y'all were so talented because dancing, because you dance too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Can dance.
Got cut a rug.
We used to kill each other. Woo, we used to kill it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's funny now just to see you in this position. But I always saw you always had that passion in you, even back then. I could see it in your eyes. You always had that drive and that hunger. So it's awesome to see you doing. And he looks like a baby, right? Like, for real. You know you're cute.
I'll take it. So, I receive that.
Receive it. So, we got a Twitter question.
Yes.
We also would like to know, what advice do you have for aspiring songwriters? And is it okay to present someone a song with a track that is not originally yours?
For songwriters, the best advice or the advice I believe the most is write honestly. Like, I find that a lot of writers and artists now, they write and perform to fit in. And the problem with that is it becomes bland and no one cares. As opposed to if you write that single thought that made so much sense to you that you had to say it, and then people who aren't writers can then appreciate what you're doing and then appreciate that it's a higher level, it's more thought in it, and that's your gift. It's like, Stevie Wonder has a song, it's like one of my favorite songs, right? It's called Rocket Love. And it's like the most optimistic sounding, depressing record ever. Because the song is about almost getting there. And it's like, you took me riding on a rocket, gave me a star, and then a half a mile from heaven, you dropped me back down to this cold world. It's like, that's fucked up. But you feel it in a way that you know that it's literally up. It's like his ad libs are you. I wouldn't do that to a dog. but he wrote that from a real place.
Speak to the highs and lows of your journey, because I know you've gone from LaFace and you're Atlantic now.
Yeah, I'm in Atlantic.
So, you know, speak to that.
I can't tell you. I don't know a low yet. I've had. I've been blessed to have a lot of success with a lot of different things, and even in, like, every success I've had, I've always felt like, okay, now it's reset time. It's time to start over, because that happened already. Like, I can't walk around like OutKast, you know, because there's a point where that's 10 years ago, or that's 20 years ago. I can't ride on those things. So, the successes have been about wanting to feel what success feels like again. It's almost like I'm really like a junkie for greatness and success, because I like that feeling.
Right.
I like the feeling of doing something so well that you don't have to talk about it. That people just, they recognize
it.
Yeah, it actually happened. So we ain't got to deal with that no more. Let's just, now we can move on, and that helps to move to the next thing.
What about, like, personally?
You
have your highs and lows in that space.
Oh, Oprah. Let me say this. I've been extremely, extremely successful in my career. But relationships sometimes, you know, they take a L, because it's really hard to be extremely passionate and committed to too many things.
Yeah.
And, you know, my kids, they come first. And it's them, you know, music, you know, God first, because without, you know, God, the kids wouldn't be here. I had enough money to be attractive to this person who helped me get these kids. You know, it's like, you know, you know, it's a lot, man. So.
Now that's funny.
No. But, you know, and support these kids, man. They eat. But
you
no,
beautiful
it's
children too.
I like them. I like my kids. They
come. Glad you do. I'm glad
crazy.
You like your kids, Kippy.
Yeah. Like if they weren't my kids, I would still like my kids.
You should.
But the hardest part about it is it's time. You don't. It's everybody has the same 24 hours.
Yeah.
So when you see people who are really successful, you gotta assume that they put a lot of time mm-hmm. into doing that. Mm-hmm. But you also have to know that there are casualties. Of that focus.
T.I.
Yes.
You had something to do with that, a little bit to do with that, a lot of it.
Slightly,
so,
yeah.
Yeah. I remember when you brought him to LaFace. Mm-hmm. I remember that. Talk about that and T.I. now. Now.
T.I. now is the tip that I met.
Yeah.
Like, he's literally not... He's one of the most consistent, loyal friends that I have.
He's actually a really good person.
Yeah, he's
a
great quality person.
He really is.
You know, and he, you know, even when he does stuff that's not so, you know, great to other people, he at least accepts his part in everything he does.
He's very genuine.
Yes, he's genuine. So it's like, you know, the conversations are they're hilarious.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you'll catch an 8-syllable word every now and again. Like in a real unnecessary place, like.
Right.
But again, it's the writer in him.
Yeah, I love that. But so, he tells a story. I mean,
every time.
You know, from what
Bankhead. Like
yeah,
he's like the Bankhead Tom.
Yeah, so.
Like he's writing Tom Sawyer over there.
Twitter question.
I'm sorry. You know what? No, I don't think I've compromised anything that I believe or believe in. Mm-hmm. I think that's the thing that's kept me in the music industry. I've never had an issue where, like, if I felt it, like one of the first videos when I was in a group, we had this song and this director kept telling me that next to my turntables, he was going to put this 40, mm-hmm. but I didn't drink. So it just didn't make sense. And I was like, so why?
Right.
He was like, you know, just to make it more urban and
right.
more hip hop. I was like,
but
I'm hip hop, but I don't drink.
Right.
Like, I just don't. And I remember the guys in my group like, man, KB, stop tripping. I'm like, no, y'all hold it. Like, I don't drink. You actually drink it. You hold it. And it got dealt with. But afterwards, that's when Pebbles came to me and said, man, you probably should be an executive.
I don't think you fit right.
Yeah, she was like, cause you're right. She was like, you're right. But the thing is, his job, the director, he's been hired to paint a picture.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, but I'm in it.
Yeah.
So, and it was like, but it was one of those things that it that was that place where I hit this wall. Like, let me make a left here, and then I started paying more attention to the business. Mm-hmm. And those were the things that, like, each one of those things kind of. Hit another thing. It's like it's a maze that it was unintentional, but I ended up in this space just by continuing to be me.
Talk about, I know LA was your mentor.
Mm-hmm. One of them, yeah.
Yes, one of your mentors. How did he influence your life?
You know what? LA actually helped us understand the idea of, and it sounds weird, but like black class. Mm-hmm. Like there was such a, first of all, the company, LaFace was such a family that we actually had family meetings and you know, we dealt with things really as if we cared about each other. And that kind of instilled, okay, would you really do this outside? Would you want anybody else to see you do this? Like, so I've always, no matter whether it was a tweet, whether it was, you know, anything that I do, I want to make sure that you get an impression of who I am. You get the soul of it.
Of who you are.
And that's what, like, LA made sure we understood, like, we're black, so we have to maintain what black is. Don't, you know... We're all grown up kind of here. Don't be a about it. Like be black about it. Like that way you can walk anywhere with your head high and it's fine.
Do you think that the industry needs a facelift right now? The music industry?
I would probably go with Enema. Because because it's not the faces, it's the insides of it. Mm-hmm. It's like it's not a lot of substance in it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but the thing is, and I'm not acting like it's always substance. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, Mary Jane is a song about weed.
Right.
you know, but it was clever.
The way you presented it, you didn't know.
Like, at yeah. six, I didn't know who yeah. Mary, I thought Mary Jane yeah. was a person.
I did too. I think but, y'all did.
But this, my point is, like, it just needs better, it needs more substance, more talent.
Speak to what an A&R really is, what your job is, yeah. and, you know, what type of artists do you seek when you do go on social media? What do you look for?
Okay, so A&R, the initials mean artists and repertoire. It means the people who create and the handling of the things that they create.
Right.
So sometimes it's finding an artist who you think is cool because they were walking through the mall, but then developing it into something that people can appreciate.
Speak to the development. What's the development?
Okay, so let's use Jermaine because I was yeah. in that place. Okay, so Jermaine Dupri, talented. He's like super talented. Like, he has the ability to make something that doesn't exist, right? He can sit at a drum machine, make a record, and you like it. It translates. What he's smart at is, because he writes the record, it doesn't mean that he thinks he's supposed to do it. But these two kids, like, this thought I had might have been a very, it could be an elementary thought. It's just a big elementary thought. Let's put some big personalities on it. And you match things. It's almost like it's tailoring. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's casting. Development is just finding out what people are good at and focusing on that part mm-hmm. to make that seem bigger than life. Because it's probably going to have to be big enough to cover up something that they're not good at.
Right.
You know, so it's just about understanding talents and understanding mm-hmm. gifts and knowing what yours are and understanding what people are lacking sometimes mm-hmm. and even knowing people who could provide that part. Mm-hmm. So for me, it's relationships. It's, I know some of the most talented people.
Right.
And I know, like, some of my best friends are really, like, culture shifters. So it's kind of a, for me as an A&R, my responsibility is to not put bad energy or bad information in the room, because these people suck up the information and they put it back out into the world.
Right.
Because I'm usually the person closest to a lot of the artists.
Yeah.
So if they ask me, so KP, people like that? Or, you know, what did anybody say about this? And you have to be able to get the information in and get it to where they can understand it, but also where they can transform it into something cool.
Right.
Like, let's say Get Up, Get Out. It's an Outkast record with CeeLo. We all were sitting in the studio talking one day, just randomly, and we were talking about how, man, like, this, it feels like it's working, but we ain't got no money. And man, my grandma was really tripping because she, like, I'm hanging out. It seems like I'm having fun,
right.
and I'm not contributing.
Right.
CeeLo was like, man, my aunt said that same And then literally went into another room, came back to do his verse on Get Up, Get Out, and it started. I don't recall ever graduating at all. And sometimes I feel like I'm just a disappointment to y'all. Every day I just lay around and I can't be found. I was asking, give me some, living life like a bum. But it's that line where it says, my auntie had enough. Like, it's like, you know, you're supposed to be grown. Like, it's
I
like,
know it's the, not true.
But that's the thing. It's like, you know the
you
truth
know
in it. Like,
yeah.
but you have sometimes, whoever is in that space,
yeah.
that creative space, is affecting the conversation, which mm-hmm. is affecting the thought process.
Right.
Which is like, it's sometimes inception. It's sometimes like I've literally, like, you know, God rest the dead, Pimp C. We had a record on the group that we had at PA. We had a record with Pimp C on it. And Pimp was like sitting there trying to figure out how he was going to start his verse. And I for real said, hey man, remember that time you said, I'm coming out of Houston with some D.O. from a trunk? He was like, I said that. That sound cool. Yeah, all right. And he took that piece, but then made the rest of the record. But it's just like, understand how to kick in, like, you know, because, you know, sometimes talented people can overthink as well.
Oh yeah,
like,
definitely.
As a producer, I do it. As a writer, I do it.
Yeah.
But the stuff that works the most mm-hmm. is the real thought.
Yeah. Now in this age and where you're at now, is it hard for you, because you work with so many great artists, to find artists to sign now?
Actually, I think it makes it easier, because mm-hmm. what I know now is there's a commonality between the really, really great artists. Mm-hmm. They're really brave. They're really, really honest in their art. And And if you bring a new person in a room with the people that you're already around, if they don't fit, it, you notice it really fast.
Right.
So it's like, I kind of look at my friends, it's like a crew of X-Men. Like they got real superpowers. Yeah. Like Dre can walk out on stage in a diaper and nobody say nothing.
That's cool.
It's cool. He made that cool. Right. Y'all got, excuse me. I'm honest, though. The honest feeling comes out sometimes. But he makes that so cool that he's like, man, you saw that? Mm-hmm. As opposed to, man, what's that?
Right.
But a new artist is like, if they come in the room and, again, I'll use Tip. The first time I took Tip out of town, I took him to L.A. for the Source Awards. We went out there, and it was the year that Outkast, Goody Mob, like, the Dungeon Family was on fire. We had a record called Watch for the Hook, Cool Breeze had out, everybody was on it. Cool Breeze was scared to fly. So Cool Breeze took a van from Atlanta to L.A.
Woo.
He did not make sound check.
Oh, no.
So Tip had to do Cool Breeze's camera blocking, yeah, which is the part where you go up there and they want to know where everybody's going to be. And they started doing a record, and they were like, Tip, you got to be Cool Breeze. He's like, all right, Charlotte, I got it. So he gets up there, and when it gets to Cool Breeze's part, Tip says he knows all the words. He actually performed the song. Mm. Like, if you can imagine Tip doing Ain't About the Money, but as doing Cool Breeze's lyrics, he was performing it. Everybody was like, because they didn't know Tip. Mm. Like, it was literally the first day they met him. So everybody was like, shout out, all right.
He nice.
All right, hey. If Breeze don't make it.
He can do it.
But you have to be able to stand up in a, if you want to be a giant, you got to be able to stand up in a room of giants.
Yeah,
so it's like, it can't be, yeah, shout out, hey man, you got some tea? You know, if that preparation to be great,
yeah,
has to happen before I meet somebody.
Way before, right.
Like if it's on me, then I'm the artist now. Mm-hmm. Like, you're now my canvas, mm-hmm, as opposed to me seeing that you have a point of view, a vision, or at least a goal,
right,
that I can help you get to.
Would you, artists now, mm-hmm, anybody that's looking to, you know, make it big in the industry, would you suggest independently or major label?
Yeah, I would say that you should start everything independently, because that way you know what you have.
Mm-hmm.
You know how much effort you got to put into it.
Yes.
You know, I think in the YouTube generation of it, you miss some of the fundamentals. You miss things that, like, you miss getting punched and getting up. You miss a lot of just the I'm missing shots first.
Mm-hmm.
Like, nobody practices. I've seen artists have a record and get paid $15,000 to come to a club, and then they're rapping over the song as it's on the radio. Like,
right,
they haven't prepared it for the show. They don't have show,
right,
versions.
Yeah, TV versions.
Yeah,
TV.
So uh-huh, it's like the fundamentals are missing a little bit. And I think that the artists now, they gotta now research, use YouTube and use the internet for research as well. Because,
mm-hmm,
all the information is there.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you can look up Sammy Davis Jr., you can look up Richard James Brown practicing. Like, I've watched videos of him rehearsing. So it's like, it's too much information for you not to know how great people got great.
I think though, we live in a society now that applauds mediocrity. They like mediocre things. Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, it's you find people that want to be excellent. I'm not saying, mm-hmm, that, but as a whole, you know, that's just where we are right now.
I mean, but the thing is, okay, it's for me, I don't blame the person who's being mediocre and, mm-hmm, getting applause. I blame the people who are egging it on. It's like, yeah, you know how your teachers used to say, mm-hmm, don't laugh at that boy.
Right. Like, right.
Like, it's because they don't know the difference in laughing because it was funny or you're laughing at them.
But you know what I think it is, KP? I think we, you know, the generations that have come before the artists now, or just the people in general, we dropped the ball because we haven't said, let me take you under our wing and say, this is what really is. You know what I mean? This is what
I
the steps
you
have to take. But I'm saying as a whole. We have individuals that do that, but as
a
whole.
No, I'm not even saying that. I'm saying that the difference now is kids don't have to wait for you to say okay.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's, I had the thought, I put it on the world. It's in the world now. Like, no, I don't go to you to see, how does this measure up? Like, mm-hmm, I'm like, I know a lot of artists, I know I have family members who sing or rap, and instead of coming to me to say, hey, what do you think? Listen to this right quick. They will put it on YouTube for the entire world to say, man, you a clown.
Right.
Like, and I could have said that and nobody would have heard it. And I can say why. I can tell you why and how to fix, or at least how not to, unless you're going for clowning, like, then you might want to change something. But if you're going for clown, you killed it.
Yeah, and I mean, it's some great artists, I think, that they don't get the stage, the platform, because, you know, you find a lot of artists, they go overseas now,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that's where a lot of people think that if you don't make it in America, you don't make it, and that's just so not the truth.
No.
A lot of the artists you don't see here, they're overseas doing really, really, really well,
mm-hmm.
and you know, have you ever passed on an artist that you wish you had a sign?
Nope.
Never. Okay.
No, I mean, no, because the reason I didn't, that I passed, like, okay, here's an example of what could seem like that. But so because I did tip everything that came through on like a level of trap, hood, like every version of it
yeah.
came to me.
During that time?
During that period,
okay.
and after. So I had a meeting with Jeezy one time, but I was at Sony Records. And I was like, man, I love this. He was like, so what you want to do? I was like, man, I wouldn't sign you here.
Mm.
And he was like, why? I was like, because this building isn't set up for the way you're moving. Like, I'm watching what you're doing. You're going to have to ask permission to do a lot of things that you really just need to go do when you think it.
Right.
And this isn't the system for that. But I didn't feel bad because that same day he went from my office to Def Jam and he got the deal he was supposed to get.
Right.
Like he got the deal and the situation that actually assisted in what his movement was.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just about understanding what you can bring to a situation sometimes. It's not, and me and him are cool, like we're great. We're friends
right.
based on me being straight up.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, again, it goes back into that thing of I've never... I don't feel like I've lost anything, like, but what I do have is I have friends at other places. So me being at Sony didn't define whether I'm good at my job or not.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So it's one of those things. It's like you have to just be confident in your decision making based on why you made the decision.
Right.
Like if you think it through, it'll be fine. Like if you think it through about what you really want to do,
mm-hmm.
like there are people I know who are really talented that I have no interest in being involved with because I don't feel like dealing with them.
Right. I got you. Because, I mean, and that's another thing. A lot of people think it's just about the music and the talent, but it's also about who you are as a person.
As a person, yeah.
Because now we're in the age where you have to sell who you are as a person,
mm-hmm.
and that's important. And it can be a lot. You know, artists can be a lot, you
yeah.
know. So, so now, what are you doing, KP?
Well, I'm Senior VP of A&R at Atlantic Records.
Okay.
Me and Pharrell have figured out that we should do our business together from an executive artist kind of thing.
Mm.
So we're building something that's really, really interesting and I love it. I'm doing some TV stuff. We associate produced the ATL Rise documentary.
I love it. Yep.
Thank you.
We need second half.
We need
half.
More. Like, we need more time. It's just 70
we
minutes.
We need it.
We're doing a bunch of stuff. Some stuff I can talk about,
right,
but it's a lot. I'm having fun.
Mm-hmm.
I'm doing what I did when I was 13. I'm looking at things I like, figuring out where I can help make it bigger,
mm-hmm.
and you know, and in the meantime, doing things creatively that I like to do that you know that doesn't impose on other people sometimes.
Okay, well, leave everybody with a word.
Peace.
And tell everybody where they can find you.
Right now, right here, and on social media, it's just my name. It's at Kawan Prather, KawanPrather.
Okay.
And, you know, I'm around.
Cool. But thank you so much, KP.
The world.
Love you guys.